Western classical music is considered the preserve of a snobbish elite. It's an exclusive party to which a few are invited. How ironic, how sad, because this is an art form which has the closest emotional connect with the human soul. Western classical music is all around us. Since we enjoy it so much, we decided to take you along on this beautiful journey. This journey of 1,000 years of this living unbroken tradition of the Western classical music began 1,000 years ago. This music is our closest companion. It is there with us in our moments of distress, in our crises, but also in our moments of joy. Listen to this Mozart piece, the Little Serenade, the Einklein Nachtmusik, a perfect accompaniment to romantic serenade. Einklein Nachtmusik. This journey of 1,000 years began with the Gregorian chants in the Gothic period, traveled across Europe during the Renaissance with the motets and madrigals, was soon overtaken by the overwhelming and the extremely ornate Baroque period. The music was as ornate as the furniture and the architecture. This was followed by the dawn of the Age of Enlightenment. Music now was not a mirror to the mind of God. Instead, it reflected the inner struggles and the beauty of the man himself. And then there was the advent of the big three. And the big three were Bach, Mozart, and Beethoven. Douglas Adams says, Beethoven tells you what it is like to be Beethoven, the individual. Mozart tells you what it is like to be human, pure and simple. But Bach tells you what it is like to be the universe. Johann Sebastian Bach, that colossus of the Baroque period, is considered the greatest musical genius that ever walked on this earth. Although unappreciated in his own time, his works, the Mass in D minor, St. Matthew's Passion, and the Brandenburg Concertos, are considered the most iconic musical pieces ever written. The second of the titans was Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, an Austrian composer and a brilliant pianist. He was a child prodigy. He is considered the first true rock star of the Western classical music. We'll hear more about Mozart a little later in the session. But the supreme iconic figure of the Western classical music was Ludwig von Beethoven, a German composer and a brilliant pianist. He called himself as a poet in sound. With his profound genius and innovative capabilities, he totally transformed the entire face of the Western classical music. He broke all boundaries and he believed that individual should take precedence over the tradition. Two of his symphonies, the Fifth Symphony, also known as the Victory Symphony, and the Ninth Symphony, which contains the Ode to Joy, are two of the most beautiful works in the entire domain of the Western classical music. There were other brilliant composers too. If you love truth and beauty, if you love harmony and melody, listen to Tchaikovsky. No one can paint human emotion as brilliantly and beautifully as Tchaikovsky can. His music is the most accessible and the most enjoyable. No wonder Tchaikovsky is the third most performed composer right across the world after Beethoven and Mozart. Two of his ballets, the Nutcracker Suite and the Swan Lake, which is depicted here, are the masterpieces of the ballet tradition. There were other great composers too. Antonio Vivaldi, the Red Priest, whose The Four Seasons is considered the ultimate in the concerto tradition. Richard Wagner, the master of opera, Franz Haydn, the father of symphony, and Johann Strauss Jr., the king of waltz. But my own personal favorite is Gioachino Rossini, When it comes to comedy and music, there are no parallels, no comparisons. His opera Buffa, the opera Seville, and the William Tell Overture are the most delightful pieces of classical music that you will ever hear. Listen to this Looney Tune cartoon short based on the Barber of Seville, his popular opera Buffa. It has been immortalized in the popular culture. One of the best ways to get hooked to the Western classical music is through the movies. Stanley Kubrick's epic science fiction movie, the 2001 Space Odyssey, is one of the best marriages, the best blends of the art of cinema with the classical music. Richard Strauss' thundering strains from the Dasyapik Zarathustra accompany the opening scene of the music, which is the birth of the mankind. Listen to the thundering strains of Richard Strauss in this grand spectacle of the birth of mankind. Fantasia by Disney is the perfect introduction to the classical music. In this timeless extravaganza of sight and sound, the timeless pieces of the Western classical music meet the wonder and imagination of Walt Disney and this wonderful music composed by Stokowski to accompany it. And then there's Amadeus, one of the finest movies of all time, winner of 8 Academy Awards. It looks at the life of Mozart through the eyes of his competitor and rival, Antonio Salieri. And it's packed with the finest pieces of Mozart's music, The Marriage of Figaro, Don Giovanni, and also the heartrending Requiem. It's an absolute must for all classical music lovers. And in the more recent times, one of the most iconic musical scores of any movie is that from Star Wars, the magical and the majestic Imperial March from The Empire Strikes Back, by the one and the only John Williams, The Imperial March from The Empire Strikes Back. He also composed the music for E.T. and The Schindler's List. And closer home, we have the Symphony Orchestra of India since 2006, located at the NCPA in Mumbai. They're doing a great job. And they also sometimes come to Delhi to perform, and that's the time you can catch them. Apro Jubin, Zubin Mehta, is India's internationally acclaimed conductor of the Western classical music, has performed and conducted some of the finest philharmonic orchestras in the world. Just a few suggestions to enhance your joy. Listen, don't just hear. And if you invest a little time into understanding the intricacies and the complexities of the Western classical music, you will be rewarded enormously. have a partner in crime. Just like in all fine arts, sharing enhances the joy of listening to the Western classical music. Find a friend who's passionate about classical music. And we are lucky that we have so many of them here at Lit Agra. Attend a live concert, if possible. It takes your experience to an absolutely different level. We, in 1997 in Agra, were lucky to witness a grand spectacle at the backdrop, the Taj as the backdrop, with Gianni, the great musician, the Greek musician, playing piano. It was a grand spectacle, and many of our friends here in the audience were there, I'm sure. Another beautiful way of getting hooked to the classical music is through the movies, as you just mentioned. And one of my recommendations is a movie with a strong classical music base, Brief Encounter by David Lean. It has a piano concerto by Sergei Rachmaninoff, a beautiful piece, which is the finest in the romantic tradition and one of the most beautiful pieces that you will ever hear. Listen to Benjamin Zender's fascinating TED Talk about the transformative power of classical music. With his passion and energy, Zender can convert even the most skeptical of the audiences into the ardent fans of Western classical music. Technology has democratized the access to classical music today. YouTube is a huge treasure house of classical music videos. My personal favorite is WatchMojo's 10 most iconic pieces of the classical music. You can go to Spotify for your daily dose of classical music. And there are lists of the wonderful piece of classical music that everyone must listen to. Beethoven, Mozart, Vivaldi, Bach. These are the great masters, but you don't have to follow the list. Follow your heart, take your pick, and join us on this fabulous journey of Western classical music. And we promise you that we will rock you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhatia. That was such a beautiful introduction. And I'm sure everybody is now just ready to dive into the world of Western classical music. So now when we talk about, when anybody mentions Western classical music, I don't know about others, but for me, I definitely see a lot of musical notes floating in the air in front of me. And if I probably ask you now to recite a few notes, you'd probably sing me Do Re Mi Fa Sol La Ti. Thanks to the wonderful movie, The Sound of Music, everybody knows the basic sol. But do you know how this solmization came about? Solmization, or the practice of assigning syllables to the different notes of the scale, originated in India, like the swar. It enables to mentally hear the pitches of a piece of music being seen for the first time and then sing them out loud. It was in the 6th century that Isidore, the Archbishop of Seville, lamented that unless sounds are held by the memory of man, they perish, because they cannot be written down. But it wasn't until the 11th century that Guido di Arezzo, a Benedictine monk and a master of music, got to work to prevent many sacred tunes from getting lost. Guido was familiar with solmization and noted that most of the famous Gregorian chants at that point of time could easily be learned by singers if they could see the tone progression up and down the scale and associate it with the sound. He assigned notes of the scale of a hexachord, C, D, E, F, G, and A, a syllable each. Ut, Re, Mi, Fa, So, and La. Those were just random sounds that he chose. They were taken from a Latin hymn, Utque in Laxis, which was famous at that point of time in the Middle Ages, and it was chanted in the church for prayers. I will just play that hymn, Oetzer, if you would. And please notice that in each succeeding line of this hymn begins on the next scale degree, so that each note's name was a syllable sung at that pitch in this hymn.
Fabuli tu honum, so
So as you must have noticed, each begins on a next scale, and this is how we got our do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. Ut was later changed to do, and the syllable C was added to complete the diatonic scale. C was also later changed to T, so that every syllable might begin with a different letter. This type of solfège is used in places like Italy, Portugal, France, Latin America, Russia, etc. However, in countries like US and UK, they teach you to start with musical scale ABC. So this is the way we got our musical notes. They got their names. And now we will hear from Neelam ma'am and Sonali, the history of the evolution of Western classical music, a journey that is never ending and ongoing, as close and as distant as the horizon. Neelam ma'am, please. You are on mute.
Isn't it cruel that music should be so beautiful? It has the beauty of loneliness and pain, the beauty of disappointment and never satisfied love. It has the beauty of spring and the sadness of autumn, and the darkness of winter, and it is eternal, ever-changing and ever-present. And to narrate the history of something that is eternal and ever-changing is a very, very difficult task. Today, when we talk of the history of classical music, we are talking of all notated music. We are talking of music performed from a written score. That is what we mean when we're talking of classical music. So here the history that I'm going to present, that we are going to present, Sonali and I, is from 1000 AD to the present day. You can see the span, and of course in a few minutes to present all the history is almost impossible. So it's just a very, very brief history. So, and it is impossible to divide one age from the other. There is no clear-cut barrier that this age ends here and another begins. There is constant evolution and revolution going on all the time. However, musicologists want to put history into watertight compartments. So we have these six ages. So we have the medieval, Renaissance, Baroque, classical, romantic, and modern. So let's start with the music of the Middle Ages and Renaissance. A long period from 1000 AD to 1600 AD. This is music from the Middle Ages. Was basically religious, dedicated to God, to be sung in churches. It transmitted the message of God. It was a medium of projection of sacred texts, a vehicle for spiritual contemplation. But there was another music. It was a music of the courts, secular music, which was non-religious. It was dance music. Basically, music was functional in nature. And surprise, the strains of medieval music can be heard in this very popular number. I'm sure all of you can identify it.
Oh,
So this is influence of medieval music right up to the present times. Renaissance followed the Middle Ages. It was the age of Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, Shakespeare, Copernicus, Magellan. Great things were happening in the world. And sacred and secular music evolved. Music moved beyond the churches, beyond the courts, and entered homes. Popular musical instruments of that time were the organ, the lute, the harpsichord, trumpets, shawms, and sackbut. But what revolutionized music was the invention of the printing press. Now, musicians carried the music made by composers far and wide. Vocal music became very popular at that time, and a cappella music, that is, singing without music, was the trademark of the Renaissance times.
From the Renaissance, we move into the Baroque age, which lasted from 1600 to 1750. The Baroque era has two distinct goalposts at either end. It began with the creation of a new musical genre of the opera around 1600 and ended with the death of Bach in 1750. Well, Baroque comes from a Portuguese word, baroco, a pearl of irregular shape. Baroque, therefore, means something irregular, untamed, flamboyant, dramatic, grandiose. In this age, instrumental music became as important as vocal. Violin provided the melody and harpsichord the bass and harmony. Rhythms were repetitious and music energetic. The opera emerged. Entire dramas were now set to music. Operas included acting, singing, scenery, costumes, properties, and lighting. Claude Monteverdi is regarded as the first major opera writer. Greek mythology, Roman history, and plays by Frenchmen provided the stories for these operas. Orchestras became big in size and used strings, flutes, bassoons, trumpets, and drums. Another popular form in those days was the concerto, which included a soloist or soloists performing against an orchestra. Vivaldi was the master of the concerto, his most famous being the Four Seasons. Here is an excerpt from the Spring Concerto. No description of the Baroque era can be complete without talking of Handel and Bach. Both were born in 1685, but there could not have been two more contrasting characters. Bach was modestly dressed, Handel in finery. Bach composing in mid-sized German towns, Handel in large theaters and in London. Bach seeking perfection and integrity, and creating music for the greater glory of God. Handel working to please his audience on earth. Bach is in the eternal looking perfectionist. Handel, the external looking projectionist. Handel's most famous works are Messiah, Water Music, and Fireworks. Let's hear an excerpt from Water Music. Bach was a genius, born in a family of musicians. However, it was only 150 years after his death that people realized his greatness, dug up his body from a local parish church, and reburied him in a place of honor, the high altar of St. Thomas Church, and finally put up a huge stained glass image of his. This is Bach.
These small pieces of music are only meant to whet your appetite and make you want to listen to more. Bach died in 1750, and that became the starting point for the classical age in Western classical music. Timeless beauty with rhythm, melody, and tone blended perfectly was the high point of the classical age. This was the age of the French and the American revolutions of philosophers and writers like Rousseau and Adam Smith, and in music of immortals like Mozart, Beethoven, and Haydn. Music in this age changed from the aristocratic Baroque to a more democratic one. The cultural movement was from the ornate to the simple. Haydn was the soul of classicism, composer of more than 100 symphonies, godfather of the string quartet and the sonata. And most importantly, he was a teacher to both Mozart and Beethoven. I'm sure some of you may know his composition, The Emperor's Hymn, is sung as the national anthem of Germany today. Mozart is history's greatest natural musician, a flame which burnt brightly but briefly for only 35 years. And Beethoven is the immortal thunderer. It was a custom in those days to have a nobleman or aristocrat patronizing these artists. And Haydn and Mozart served under such patronage. But Beethoven was the independent, passionate thunderer who bowed to no man. This was a period of art for art's sake, of clear thought, of discipline, of self-control, of beauty, of form, of great creativity and imagination. Vienna became the center of classical music, with Mozart, Haydn, and Beethoven all gravitating to Vienna, settling there, becoming the toast of Vienna, and finally dying there. So what came from this most famous of all ages in music? Mozart wrote the finest operas of all time, Don Giovanni, The Magic Flute, and The Marriage of Figaro. Haydn composed the best oratorio in music history. Symphony and string quartet reached its ultimate height, and the keyboard sonata was perfected by Beethoven. So let's hear some Beethoven. Beethoven's Ode to Joy is the anthem for the European Union today. So we are going to learn more about Beethoven and Mozart later, but let's end this age with a little music from Mozart. Phenomena like Mozart is an inexplicable thing. Bernard Shaw said of Mozart that Mozart music is so beautiful it would not sound out of place in the voice of God. So that was Shaw for Mozart.
Next is the Romantic Age. Romantic period took up most of the 19th century and ended with the disillusionment of the First World War. The democratic, individualistic spirit that was set loose in the world from the end of the 18th century was inevitably reflected in the arts of all kinds. The arts favored individual expression and emotion. It was the time of freedom, of dreams, of God, and of nature. A kinship developed between literature, poetry, and music. Mood music was in fashion, sad, majestic, and tender. Nationalism was in the songs, and sounds were sensuous. Straddling both the classical and romantic age was Franz Schubert, a musical prodigy who, like Mozart, died young. In the early years of the romantic age, there was the intimacy of Frédéric Chopin
the thundering piano concerts of Liszt, the love songs of Schumann, the dazzling orchestration of Berlioz, the restraint of Mendelssohn, and the dramatic brooding of Wagner. Have you noticed one thing missing in all of this narrative of musical history? Yes, women. Women were till the 19th century denied their rightful place as composers. Robert and Clara Schumann were the only power couple in musical history. Clara was a music prodigy in her own right, but marriage to Robert Schumann brought her career to an end. It was only in the 20th century that women were put on an equal footing. During the Romantic Age, the orchestra expanded exponentially, sometimes even having more than 400 musicians. Instrument making advanced too. Walls were developed for horns and trumpets, which enabled them to change their pitch and produce additional tones. Strings were now made of wire instead of animal gut. The three forms of music which grew were symphony orchestra, symphonic poem, that is a musical story, and piano music and art songs. This was the golden age of piano and the dance form of waltz. The Polish composer Chopin is the undisputed piano composition king. Here is Chopin. The 19th century was the high watermark for program music, in which a story is told through music, and of absolute music, which conveyed only feelings and emotions without any story. The opera form was extremely popular. And then a sudden hush came over concert halls. The idea of quiet entered now. Music had become an art to be heard in reverential silence.
Well, 1900 onwards begins the modern age. So it was a radical departure from traditional music. Actually, the 20th century is a musical hodgepodge. And it is not at all surprising for a century where that began with men riding on horses. Only 2/3 of the century had gone by when man had landed on the moon. Man was walking on the moon. So vast change that came in the life of people, and a vast change that came in music also. And of course, there were the two world wars in between. So we can roughly divide this modern age into three periods. One is Impressionism, second, Modernism, and the third, Postmodernism. They are different from each other, and yet they overlap each other. Impressionism in music came into existence when composers began to move away from the romanticism and created music which was more difficult to sing. Debussy is one of the greatest of the impressionist musicians. Impressionism gave way to modernism. Now there was unparalleled musical experimentation. Unusual things were being done with the melody, harmony, rhythm, and form. Electronic music, microtonal music, serial music, mixed media music, which combines sound plus special lighting, plus dance, plus film, plus balloons, plus audience participation, all came into existence. Rhythm and vocal became more important. Melody took a backseat. Orchestras became smaller, and there was an emphasis on technique rather than on content. Jazz and rock had a great impact upon classical music. Too many 20th century musicians experimented for the sake of experimentation, ignoring that communication is the primary function of art. Modern ballet came of age early in the 20th century. And after World War II, the centers, the great centers of musicians moved from Europe to America. and New York became the new center with composers like Aaron Copland and John Adams coming to the forefront. Big names of the modern age of classical music include Ivor Stravinsky and Schoenberg, Ralph Vaughan Williams, Béla Bartók, Paul Hindemith, and Dmitri Shostakovich, one of the greatest of the modern age. Here's a piece of music by Shostakovich. And now we are in the postmodernism time, in a world where everyone is an equal. Everyone can be an art lover and everyone can be an art critic. Postmodernism glorifies the mundane and pays attention to the minimal everyday things. Music also has become more minimal, friendly and simple. Today, as we enter the third decade of the 21st century, it may appear that classical music is declining. But there are hopeful signs. Of course, there are hopeful signs. We are discussing classical music in Agra, so far away from the Western world, is a sure sign that classical music is not going to decline. So new rhythms, new sounds, new scales, new harmonies have entered the musical world. And the pace of change is as fast as the change in our own lives. Who knows how this music will be judged in the next century. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Neelam, ma'am, and Sonali for that incredible and insightful journey. Well, moving on to our next topic, any talk on Western classical music would be incomplete without delving into the lives of its greatest composers, Mozart and Beethoven. Now, when we talk about Mozart, we cannot but help but mention Haydn, who was his teacher and close friend. So here's an interesting fact about Haydn. After a week after Haydn's death, his grave was dug up and his skull was stolen by two phrenologists, people who studied the brains of geniuses. Now people were not very happy with this, and so they replaced a fake skull, but it wasn't until 1954 that Haydn got reunited with his real skull, and now his tomb has two skulls. I now request Sarika and Deepika Bhabhi, who will lead us into the amazing life of Mozart, whom Tchaikovsky called Music Christ.
Deepika, will you start?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Western classical music has always fascinated me, and I feel privileged to speak about Mozart. Wright has said, if you ever feel your life coming apart, listen to Mozart. Rakesh Bhatia, sir, has already introduced him to us, and it was a beautiful presentation, sir. And now, to continue, I will just highlight the basic life history of Mozart, and then Sarika Bhabhi will talk about the greatness of his music. Mozart, genius as prodigy, genius as creator, a genius who burned bright and then died young. That was Mozart. We get a peek into his life through 600 surviving letters flowing between him and members of his family, mostly with his father. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, or Wolfie for short, was born in Salzburg, Austria, on January 27, 1756. The child of a violinist and composer, Leopold Mozart, Wolfgang showed an affinity for music from a very early age. He had an innate sense for chords, tempo, and rhythm, which encouraged his father to start piano lessons with the then three-year-old. Mozart learned to play the violin at the age of four. By five, he had composed his first piece, a piano minuet. At 6 years, the child prodigy, along with his father and sister, also a talented pianist, was traveling Europe to perform for royalty. When he wasn't performing, little Wolfie caused his fair share of trouble. Mozart had an illustrious personality. He was precocious, craved attention, and loved washroom humor. Anecdotes describe Wolfgang as an immature, brash, and excitable. Even getting his haircut was a challenge. His barber could never get this musical genius to sit still. Mozart will think of a new idea and rush to the piano. And the barber will be brandishing his scissors behind him. You know, he'll be running behind him, brandishing his scissors. As his musical career progressed, he quickly outgrew the opportunities available to him in Salzburg. Life in Vienna suited him more. He fell in love and married Constanze in 1782. He was highly successful as a pianist and composer, allowing the family to live an extravagant lifestyle filled with fancy apartments, expensive pianos, and ample servants. Wolfgang even befriended the famed Joseph Haydn, who sang Mozart's praises. Before God, and as an honest man, I tell you that he is the greatest composer known to me, either in person or by name. Haydn would later become a strong influence on Mozart's work. Albert Einstein once declared Mozart's music as so pure and beautiful that I see it as a reflection of the inner beauty of the universe. Sadly, Mozart's lavish lifestyle and lack of savings caught up with him. Due to the ongoing Austro-Turkish war, the aristocracy had limited money to support the arts, which left Mozart without work. Compounding debt forced the family to move to inexpensive housing and borrow funds from friends and colleagues. In the last year of Mozart's life, the future looked bright. His opera, The Magic Flute, had seen astounding success, which enabled him to repay his debts. But while in Prague, for the premiere of La Clemenza di Tito, he fell ill. 2 months later, his sickness had him bedridden. Although his health was quickly deteriorating, he remained mentally engaged in writing his requiem until his final days. He died on December 5th, 1791. Thank you, friends. And now I invite Sarika Bhabhi to talk about the greatness of his music.
Hello, everybody. So amidst Corona 2020 and beyond, like Neelam ma'am said, Western music is definitely still not declining nor dying. And it's very befitting to discuss a topic like Mozart or Western music, which everybody's talking about just like Corona, and probably nobody really has a clear understanding of it. Only joking, anyways. So Mozart's indomitable character is somehow woven into our culture and everything, like from seeing the major Academy Award-winning motion pictures or seeing a Golden Globe-winning series, his music remains a core part of the repertoire of every major opera house, symphony, orchestra, or any solo performer. He has been dead now for about 225 years. His music is loved by both listeners and performers, new and old, but every Mozart fan has had to endure the shouts of boring, he sounds the same, we can't understand, across all aisles. So why are we still enamored by, you know, by him and by his music, even after two centuries? So here are few facts. I've compile them into 7 facts why Mozart should be considered as one of the greatest composers. So he was writing symphonies when we were playing with stuffed toys. His first compositions probably came at the tender age of 5. And his symphonies, they came just about 3 years later. And he composed masterfully in every musical format. Second, his total musical output is staggering, although he only lived till 35. So how many pieces did Mozart compose? We don't know, but at least 626 are known. And part of the explanation for this massive output was his ability to incredibly compose them very quickly. And things like, you know, Symphony No. 36 and 38 were each written over a course of few days. And not only that, his compositions were without error. They never needed any revision. Whereas the manuscripts of other great composers were full of scratches, scratched out passages, unintelligent scribble, and Beethoven is known for that. Mozart's were strangely very, very pristine, as if, you know, the entire work was a piece of divine perfection in his head, and he was just copying it from there. He could compose anytime, anywhere. In fact, he penned his 12th horn duet, the K487, one evening in a bowling alley, and on the first page of the manuscript, he had scribbled Vienna, 27 July, 1786, while playing skittles. We all know he was a rock star on keyboard and stringed instruments, and we know that his father took him and his sister on a tour to Europe, throughout Europe, performing on piano and violin. And he came to be known as one of the greatest child prodigies of his time, capable of playing anything and everything anywhere. Then he was, he excelled at compiling and combining musical styles, foreign and local, old and new, sacred and secular. He is rumored to speak at least 15 languages and was highly aware of all musical styles from all over Europe. Like Bach before him, he masterfully incorporated these foreign fashions into his own body of works, like those of Italy, Germany, Paris, and he was a devout Freemason, and used sacred chorals, melodies in surprising settings, like his opera, The Magic Fluid. We know his sense of humor was very, very unique, and he has written some funny letters to his sisters in which all this, you know, funny humor is there. So anybody who has a funny sense of humor is able to make his compositions with both great seriousness and with great emotional depth. I think we are seeing that over here. Then how he became a great composer, one of the factors was that his family life was wreaked with, you know, financial hardships and tragedy. And we all know that luxuries and smart parents cannot bring, you know, these unknown heights. But only some hardships in your life can do that. He lost his mother at the young age of, very young age, and only two of his eight children survived infancy. So his music portrays all highs and lows of life and shows a character that is fascinatingly complex. It is impossible to argue which of Mozart's pieces is most soulful. So we will conclude that he had a knack for churning out memorable melodies nonstop. His confidence is instantly recognizable. He was a master of dramatic timing. He produced timeless works featuring perfect dramatic pacing, lifelike characters, and humanistic themes that makes them seem very fresh and relevant even in COVID times. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sarika and Deepika Bhabhi. He was an absolute genius, no doubt, and you brought him to life for us. Such a wonderful talk on him. And since you already mentioned, I'll also include a fact about him. We've all read, for everyone who's read Murakami's Killing Commendator, we're all familiar with the opera of Don Giovanni. But did you know that the opening song or the overture for the opera, Mozart wrote that in the morning of the opera's premiere, and he handed it to the orchestra just minutes before the opening, and they played it flawlessly. Like, just as you mentioned, he was so quick and he didn't need correction. It's so amazing that even as a state of massive hangover, he wrote that and it didn't need any corrections and it was played flawlessly. Moving on, we have Abha ma'am, who will be opening doors to the life of Beethoven for us. Ma'am, we cannot hear you. We still can't hear you. Ma'am, we cannot hear.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Swati, for giving me the opportunity to speak with so many great speakers. I would like Mohit to play the pieces I'd given him to play about Beethoven. This is Pure Elise by Beethoven, and it has been played by my grandson. Minuet number Minuet in G. This has been played by my granddaughter. And this is Ode to Joy. It has also been played by my granddaughter. That was Ludwig van Beethoven. Ludwig van Beethoven is quoted to have said, "I have never thought of writing for reputation and honor. What I have in my heart must come out. That is the reason why I compose." Beethoven was a German pianist and composer and is considered one of the greatest musical geniuses who ever lived. His greatest achievement was to raise instrumental music, which was still then considered inferior to vocal, to the highest plane of art. He is known as the father of the Romantic era. He abandoned the classical forms of the previous century. His most famous pieces were Symphony No. 5, Ode to Joy, Für Elise, etc. He lived in the times of great political upheaval and transition in Europe. He supported the French Revolution and loved the free thought it encouraged. His music is such that even after a century and a half in the concentration camps during World War II, prisoners took solace in his compositions. Ode to Joy has been sung at every Olympic Games since 1956. When the Berlin Wall fell, musician Leonard Bernstein conducted Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 with musicians from both sides of the divide. Today, it is the national anthem of the European Union. For a musician who lived 250 years ago, Beethoven is astonishingly present. Americans turn to his music for healing following the 9/11 trauma. He's a benchmark for recording technology. The first LP presented Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. The first compact discs were measured at 75 minutes so they could fit his full Ninth Symphony. No other musician, either before him or after, has confronted audiences with such intense range of emotions. His mark is there in much of the music we enjoy today. Beethoven was born in a family of Flemish musicians, so he had no choice but to take up music. His father recognized his talent early in life and started teaching him music with such rigor and brutality that it scarred his whole life. He was only 30 when slowly and gradually he started becoming deaf. His most important masterpieces were composed when he was practically deaf, but he had heard and played music for the first 3 decades of his life, so he could imagine in his mind what compositions would sound like. Music was his whole life. He said, "It seemed to me impossible to leave the world until I had produced all that I felt was within me." The Ninth Symphony would be his last and most famous piece. When he died in 1827 at the age of 56, some 20,000 people filled the streets for his funeral. Soldiers were called to ensure order. Never before a musician had garnered so much attention. In a way, Beethoven was the world's first rock star. But he, who never heard his own symphony, he didn't write it for himself. He wrote it for others. So it is our job to not only hear his message, but also to truly listen. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that great insight into his life. He definitely remains one of the most admired composers.
Thank you.
Now, a fact about Beethoven. Beethoven was so meticulous that he used to count out 60 coffee beans every time he had a cup. So coming up, we have a very interesting topic. Ballet versus opera, and we have none other than Sudhama, who's going to introduce us to these two beautiful art forms.
Hello, can everyone hear me?
Yes,
yeah. Okay. So, hello, friends. We've had a fabulous introduction by Dr. Rakesh Bhatia. He certainly set the momentum for this evening. And that was followed by our powerhouse of information, Neelam and Sonali, in an engaging, informative, and a very eloquent manner. And of course, we have Swati, who's threading all our thoughts very lucidly and threading all the speakers together. And Deepali, Sarika, they really brought Mozart into our lives with their anecdotes and his musical journey, literally from his birth till his grave. Amavabi, I'm so impressed with your kids. God bless them. And I love their interest in classical music. So I'm going to talk a little bit about opera and ballet. Someone once said, "My horizon on humanity is enlarged and it enriches me as a human being." he was talking about opera. What is opera? Opera by Mozart. Let me give you a few classic examples. Opera by Mozart. I speak of love awake. I speak of love in dreams. To the water, the shadows, the mountains, to the flower, the grass, the fountains. Opera by Rusalka. Tell him, silvery moon, that I am embracing him. For at least momentarily, let him recall of dreaming of me. And my favorite, the populace, the phantom of the opera. Floating, falling, sweet intoxication. Touch me, trust me, savor each sensation. So what is opera? Opera is poetry and music at its best. My introduction to first-hand opera was the populist one, that is the Phantom of the Opera. It served me well because I was hooked for life. The Phantom of the Opera is based on a novel by Gaston Leroux. The Paris Opera House is haunted by a phantom or a ghost who falls in love with a pretty young singer, Christine. Ultimately, the ghost turns out to be Eric, a deformed man who captures Christine, but ultimately releases her to her beloved, the Viscount Raoul, and then he returns to his underground lair awaiting death. The others which I've watched was Joyous Noel, which was based on World War and its tragedies, and Werther, which was just 2 years ago. That is again a tragic love triangle. Each experience has been different and enriching. It is difficult to describe it. It has to be experienced and imbibed. So I would say, whenever you get the chance, go for it. Dr. Rakesh has actually told us about movies also, which kind of give us an insight into opera. Watch them, enjoy them, and just revel in them. Opera is a form of theater which actually has music in a leading role, and the parts are taken by the singers. There are primarily two styles of singing. One is like a recitative style of singing, and two is they are the self-contained arias or the solo songs. Now, the voice types that are used in these arias are a different thing altogether. We have soprano, mezzo, contralto, counter, tenor, baritone, bass. And who were these maestros? Maria Callas, the soprano, Luciano Pavarotti, Domingo, Bocelli, Caruso, so on, so forth. We have a lot of these maestros who've given their all to opera. And now, ballet. Alexander Pushkin said, ballet is a dance executed by the human soul. And truly, truly it is, friends. It is. It's a dance executed by the soul. You don't have to know about ballet to enjoy it. All you have to do is look at it. The stretching, the rising, the gliding, the jumping, the darting, the turning, and ultimately the pirouettes, which require an insane amount of balance and technique. These are the seven steps which are used in ballet, which I just talked about. The jump, the rising, the jump, the glide, the dart, the turn, and the pirouette. The first ballet that I watched was The Nutcracker, which by Tchaikovsky at the Lincoln Center in Manhattan. Impeccable, extraordinary. It was a visual delight. And it just left you like, oh no, it's ended. I want more of it. And then the last one which I saw was last year, which was The Swan Lake, again by Tchaikovsky, that I saw in St. Petersburg. The Swan Lake is the ultimate ballet. It dances the tale of Odette and her friends, who have been turned into swans by the spell of an evil sorcerer. The spell can be broken only if Odette finds a first-time true love. Prince Siegfried chances on them while hunting. Obviously, he falls in love with Odette. So he organizes a ball to declare his undying love. But the evil sorcerer has other plans. He transforms his daughter into Odette and sends her to the ball. And the prince is tricked into proposing to her instead. So the devastated audit returns to the lake as a swan. The prince realizes his mistake and returns to find her, and together they drown in the lake. Most of the ballets and operas are tragedies. There are very few which they did tell us, which talk of humor and comic. And Neelam also mentioned in her history how the genre changed. But the Swan Lake is a soul-stirring and a poignant performance filled with grace and beauty. It was Tchaikovsky's masterpiece. So the main difference between ballet and opera is that the ballet is a type of performing art, obviously, it is dance, while opera is an art form which combines two types of singing, a sung text, which is like recitative, and a musical score in a theatrical setting. Gradually over time, these two started mingling, ballet mingling with opera. The French have the credit of bringing the ballet into the opera. And why did they do that? Because it was a distraction. People were getting a trifle bored at the opera. So this was a distraction. It allowed the honored guest to take in the view without losing their sense of the plot. It gave them a bit of reprieve. Technically, this opera ballet genre is the French Baroque lyrical style of theater. This kind of theater was obviously most popular in the 18th century, and it is still popular till date. Now, that said and done, this art form was definitely elitist, just for the royals and the nobility. In earlier times, that was decided by birth. But now, I think, nobility is actually decided by an open, intelligent, compassionate, and a beautiful mind. And that's what we get from opera and ballet. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sudama. That was beautiful. And I'm sure a lot of people, you've added it to the bucket list of a lot of people, the ballet and the opera. And I'm sure they'll be just ready to go back as soon as the COVID is over.
Yes, I hope so. Meanwhile, do it in your house, do it through the movies, listen to the music, YouTube, Zindabad.
Yes, ma'am. That reminds me, while listening to you, I remembered I read somewhere, ballet is opera for the deaf. And the way you just said how the dance forms and all are, it rings quite true.
In fact, there is an amazing, when I was reading about, they said, I just went into like certain, somebody, like I said, somebody said my horizon on humanity is enlarged and it enriches me as a human being. But somebody also said that opera is all about a man who has been stabbed and is singing just before dying. So they're mostly tragic, and they do sing the full song before they die, before they take their last breath.
Well, in continuation to the incredible facts, the did you know that the most expensive opera costume of all time was worn by Adelina Patti at Covent Garden in 1895? It was worth £15 million.
Wow.
Yes, wow. And a male ballet dancer can lift from 1 to 1.5 tons worth of ballerinas during a single performance, which equates to the weight of an average car. Imagine. Fine. Moving ahead. Music is in the very air around us. To stop the flow of music would be like stopping time itself. Incredible and inconceivable. And so classical music did not stop. It flowed and it branched out and it transformed over time. We now have Ranjini and Anuj sir, who are going to talk about the classical crossover and the fusion of classical music with other music genres and art forms. Music forms, sorry. Over to you, Ranjini.
Thank you. Such a pleasure joining all of you. This is my first time in Lit Agra, so let's hope this is going to go on forever. Pleasure being here. Well, I won't waste much time. So I'm here to talk about Western classical crossover. Exactly what is that? The reason and crux of the very creation of such a concept is essentially to appeal to a wider audience. And the need to be relevant for the changing times, trends, people, and preferences. Basically, how to market what seems redundant to many, what seems old, boring. So how to take it forward to the coming generations, how to make it more appealing to all sorts of audiences. So now, as we know, the world is changing and so is the style of music. Often people who do not have any musical background might think that classical music is boring and only for more mature audiences. In fact, the sales of traditional Western classical music albums are decreasing. And many symphony orchestras and opera companies are struggling to find endowments and audiences. It is considered that classical music today occupies a position similar to that of religion as a form of art rather than entertainment or just a background noise. Unlike popular music, classical music may be more sophisticated and complex in its form. Because of this, how can classical music be heard more easily in order for audiences who are more used to popular music understand and appreciate its form? Can classical music be presented in a new style, perhaps? This is where classical crossover is talked about. It is to appeal to a wider audience. It describes the genre of music that includes recordings of popular music by classically trained musicians, as well as collaborations between popular and classical artists. While this genre is not purely classical, it certainly integrates elements of classical music into popular music and vice versa, making classical music more accessible to modern audiences. And because classical musicians receive intensive musical training, they are able to achieve a high level of technical proficiency. So, I would like to take examples of the fact that there was this group called the Black Violin. They used to perform such pure hate classical, renditions. Eventually, they realized that they were getting less popular with the coming generations and with the coming trends, that they started collaborating with people like Kanye West, the R&B superstar, Alicia Keys, yet another one. In fact, I noticed that R&B has suddenly caught on to a very wide, group of music connoisseurs, So they have started playing together, they collaborate. So classical music musicians are collaborating with R&B, rap, hip hop kind of singers in order to be more relevant. And they, in fact, itne hit ho gaye wo ki they debuted at number one on Billboard's classical crossover chart and number four on the Billboard R&B charts. This is basically, you really cannot define what classical and what crossover is. It's like quite an amalgamation, quite a delicate blend, It's like a blurring genre where virtually anything can be incorporated, opening up new horizons for classically trained musicians and singers, and even vice versa. A lot of singers who've not even trained into classical, but because of crossover, they are getting to mingle with classical pure forms of music and come out with their own versions of this kind of an amalgamation. So now there are lots of methods by which any sort of genre can be called crossover. So one is, converting or remaking a classical work into pop songs. I mean, I would take an example of the most, a very popular song, which was released in 1972 by Lori Lieberman, Killing Me Softly. So now, once upon a time, Killing Me Softly was rendered as, I heard he sang a good song. I heard he had a style. And so I came to see him, listen for a while. there he was, this young boy, a stranger to my eyes, strumming my pain with his fingers, singing my life with his words, killing me softly with his song, killing me softly with his songs, telling my whole life with his words, killing me softly with his song. Now, with the present generation, this wasn't so popular. I mean, I remember listening to it because my parents used to romantically listen to it on their LPs, and, you know, we would be dancing around them, and, you know, this used to be the memory. But now if I today play it, my little one, my 10-year-old, doesn't seem to listen to it with as much interest. However, there came about this R&B, hip-hop reggae band called the Fugees, who made it a big hit when we were in college. And suddenly this song had a resurgence amongst the youngsters. And this was like, suddenly the beat starts, I heard he sang a good song. I heard he had a star. And so I came to see him and listen for a while. And there he was, this young boy, a stranger to my eyes. Yeah, yeah. I mean, initially it was ridiculous for a person who is such a, you know, a loyalist to the original. However, it kind of grew on because of the beats. So this, the methodology that is actually, you know, taken in order to change a certain rendition to crossover is you can utilize a certain remaking, you know, procedure, which is this. Ki thoda beats change kar do, thode hip hop vocalist, and, you know, the personality of the singer changes from a beautiful, softer spoken looking lady to a total R&B, you know, one earring and no earring here, and, you know, yo-yo kind of a presentation. So this became quite a hit. Then another one is converting pop songs into classical pieces or arranging them in a more classical style. So now this reminds me of an absolutely crazy heavy metal band called Guns N' Roses. They sang this song called Sweet Child of Mine. So they would be, oh, oh, sweet child of mine. Oh, 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 sweet child of mine. So now the entire thing was taken by this classical singer. And then he just presented the same thing. Again, now that heavy metal, Shor Sharaba music was not really enjoyed by, say, maybe my parents, though they do have their exceptional times. But suddenly it started becoming appealing, the same lyrics and the same tune, but the presentation and the personality of it was so different. It was, oh, 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 sweet child of mine. Oh, 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 sweet child of mine. Itna melody, itna tamiz is gaane mein tha ki everybody just suddenly fell for this sort of a presentation as well. So this again was all about the appeal, the reach to a wider audience, you know, from the heavy metal headache songs to a very soothing rendition of it. Then comes another one is, using instruments. It could be a very classical instrument being used on a very modern song. So now most of you are familiar with the instrument called cello, the huge violin, which is played with that very theatrical style, which was mostly used in orchestras and theaters, you know, the very artistic, arty-farty performances. However, there is this duo, I recommend this brother duo to all of you. They are called Two Cellos. There are two guys who play the cellos. And they managed to produce Michael Jackson's Smooth Criminal. Yeah, there you go. Thank you so much. This is Despacito.
Despacito.
Well, yeah, so a cello instrument, which was always associated with typical classical performances and orchestra, suddenly found its relevance in today's Despacito, Smooth Criminal, you know, so on and so forth. And then, I'll hurry it up now. Then there are, you know, examples such as Madonna, infamously famous for songs like a Virgin, Papa Don't Preach, La Isla Bonita. Now she suddenly came out with, "Don't cry for me, Argentina." Suddenly classical presentation by a Madonna, you know, who one never can associate so much with such traditional art forms. However, she managed to really pull the audience. She even won some Oscar or something for this movie that she acted in, Evita. So yeah, that. And a very funny example I'll give is another one. This group called Kula Shekhar. They took this bhajan called Govind Jaya Jaya, Gopala Jaya Jaya, Radha Ramana Hari, Govind Jaya Jaya. Kula Shekhar is a band which managed to take Govind Jaya Jaya, play it in heavy metal style, saying Govind Jaya Jaya, Gopala Jaya Jaya, Radha Ramana Hari, Govind Jaya Jaya. Suddenly, college mein, festivals mein, youngsters, you know, people who have a cigarette in their hand and everything, suddenly jumping and dancing to Govind Jaya Jaya, Gopal Jaya Jaya. Who would have thought? Yeah, that's the one. Well, yeah. So now my last example is something that I really recommend all of you to watch. This movie called Crazy Rich Asians, based in Singapore. And so Elvis Presley ka jo gana tha, I Can't Help Falling in Love with You. He sang it in his typical wise men say, only fools rush in, cause I can't help falling in love with you. Typical Elvis. Now, not too many people like Elvis. Uski kaapti awaaz hai, kaisi awaaz hai, melodrama hai, ye wo, I've heard so much, you know. However, in this movie called Crazy Rich Asians, there is this beautiful wedding scene and there is this girl who totally transforms this song's personality from the Elvis typical style to jazz. And such beautiful jazz. I mean, she sings it with this very husky voice, makes it so romantic, so heavenly, so wedding-like, so full of love. You know, there are hearts flowing all over when you listen to it, which is, wise men say, only fools rush in, cause I can't help falling in love with you. Like a river flows surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be. That's it. Well, won't take more time. Already running out. So, well, this is, I shall conclude. So there are various ways in which music can be tweaked into becoming more appealing to a wider sense of audience, which is where classical becomes classical crossovers. In order to be more appealing, this is a marketing gimmick. And of course, art deserves to be welcomed by all, one and all. So I think this was the need of the hour for every sort of a typical genre. Thank you.
Well, that was wonderful, Ranjini. I don't think much is left for me to speak, but पहले रिहर्सल कर लेनी चाहिए थी तुम्हारे साथ. Anyway, so talking about the fusion music, actually इस वेस्टर्न उसमें फ्यूजन की जरूरत नहीं थी, but Pooja Bansal, she adjusted me in this. Thank you very much for that. See, as I said, that there is music that we listen, and then there's music that comes from within. The only thing is that music should attract, be it to the ears or to the soul. So the form of music is not really important. What we have talked about all this evening, Mozart and Beethoven and all that. The form of music is not really important. Importance is that you should like it. Most important. No matter what music is this, ek sadak pe chalne wala aadmi bhi gaata hai, and you may like it, you may not like it. You may not like the best of the performers when they're performing on the stage. So how does the fusion music come? What I'm going to talk. The form of music is not really important, as I said. So urges and cravings by creative musicians expose the polyphony of Western to the monophony of Indian music to create fusion music. Western music is polyphony and Indian music is monophony. Western music is more vibrant and Indian music is subtle and soul stirring. So a fusion was made in which we could have the taste of both the things. It is like stuffing noodles in a paratha and calling it a Chinese paratha. So that's how the things come up. And as you all know, that children born out of intercaste marriages are more beautiful and more intelligent. That's how this fusion music was. Right, Ranjini?
Yes, absolutely.
So the fusion saw its rise in 80s, and but it was a challenge, friends, to mix the two genre, and it was like a chemistry, like alchemy. The new fusion has brought together hymns and rhythms from different subcontinents to capture unified attention of the audience, which we call as the global music. So what we see today, the new music, what we see is the global music. The Rolling Stones, John Lennon, Miles Davis, all joined hands to fuse with the Indian music. Adele was not left behind. She performed with Mahesh Raghavan. Ali Akbar Khan in 1955 took USA by storm, and he created the first fusion music and was nominated 5 times for Grammy. However, Pandit Ravi Shankar took the fusion music to different level and meaning. Mohit, will you play that piece, please? Mohit, Pandit Ravi Shankar. Mohit ko chai pilao yaar. See the blending of music. Yeah, please go on. Yeah. Yeah, that will do. Thank you, Mohit. So Pandit Ravi Shankar music was the offspring of Hindustani classical, Western rock, jazz, and pop. He collaborated with Yehudi, the violinist, and started the musical exchange. Fusion music took the world like a tsunami. All the Western and Indian groups conglomerated to create a conception that suited to the present generation. George Harrison, one of the Beatles, used sitar on the legendary track Norwegian Wood, a single on Beatles' 1965 LP, The Rubber Soul. I'm sure you must have listened to that. Then Rolling Stones used sitar on Paint in Black. Ravi Shankar was named Billboard Musician of the Year when he performed at Woodstock in 1969. Shakti was the collaboration of Western, Hindustani, and Carnatic music. Again, it was created by Pandit Ravi Shankar when he was trying to prove his wits by coming out with the fusion music. John McLaughlin performed Mahavishnu Orchestra under Pandit Ravi Shankar. Then Leslie Lewis produced mesmerizing composition with Zakir Hussain on tabla. Friends, not going much in detail, this is what the fusion music is, and this is how the fusion music has taken everything by storm. And as the fusion music was taking place, now you listened much to the fusion music, then you actually go to the, nobody likes to listen to Pandit Bhimsen Joshi, or I would say there are very few audience who would like to listen to Pandit Bhimsen Joshi or to Bade Ghulam Ali Khan or to Beethoven or to Mozart. People like fusion music. Along with this fusion music part, there came another very interesting thing, which I found interesting to include in this today's talk, that is vocal improvisation. Vocal improvisation is wordless vocables, nonsense syllables, or without words at all. This is called scat singing. And the person who brought scat singing was Ella Fitzgerald. Have you ever heard? You have heard R.D. Burman, you have heard the yodeling of Kishore Kumar. This is all scat singing. Because you create the music without putting syllables, it is only music and no words in that. Similarly, Western music affected the Indian music, which we are not going to talk here, but the tunes which you played, the Beethoven's tunes and the Mozart, I was just listening and I was thinking, oh, this tune was used by Raj Kapoor, you know, this tune was used by somebody else. So this is all in the system and this is how the fusion music goes. So friends, before I end, I mean, it's still 7 o'clock. I will very strongly recommend all of you to listen to YouTube and soak yourself in the world of fusion music. Listen to Stive Morgan, listen to Makis Ebliantis, Yakura, Oxygen. YouTube pe jaiye, kamre mein light kam kariye, listen to this music. It is total fusion music. You will fall in love with this. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Anit, sir, for that wonderful talk on fusion music, and Ranjini for acquainting us with this new genre of music. I'm sure it'll keep the classical music alive in the new generation. The teaming up is probably finding its way somehow into the new generation. Talking about classical crossover, didn't you know that in 1999, the heavy metal band Metallica partnered with the San Francisco Symphony, which resulted in the live album and DVD called S&M, a rare meeting of two different genres of music. Here we see a reinvention of symphony, moving out of its comfort zone and teaming up with instruments usually considered a no-no in the classical performance tradition. Coming to the last topic of our session, last but not the least, comparing the Western classical music to the Indian classical music. The origins of Indian classical music, not unlike their Western counterparts, lie in the Vedas, the ancient Hindu scriptures of 2000 years ago. How similar or different are these two? Anubhavi, will you please talk more?
Hi, everyone.
Enlighten us.
It was so good to dive deep into kinds and various types of Western music, Western classical, pop. It was beautiful. So they say that music is a very universal language, and it is natural to believe that any song or a composition which has the language of English would be Western music, and any composition which is using the Hindi language would be Indian classical music. We'll just take a little example to see how much role does the language play in the deciding whether the music is Western music or whether it is Indian music. For example, come on, turn the radio on. It's Friday night and I won't be long. Got to do my hair, put my makeup on. It's Friday night and I won't be long. It doesn't take much to say that this is hopefully sounding like Indian music, Indian classical music. In contrast to that, when we sing in the Hindi language, in this manner, kaun karat tori binati piharava mano na mano hamari batiya. So I was using the Hindi language, but hopefully it sounded like Western classical. Clearly, musical identity goes beyond the language. Any music which is
is actually made up of notes or swar. And how we interpret these make all the difference whether the music is Western classical or Indian classical. Now, Western classical music originated in the Dark Ages and was mostly individual expression, as was explained so nicely by so many people. And it is mostly based on a harmony. It is polyphonic in nature. It is more like a team sport where there are many players playing the music together. In contrast to that, when we look at the Indian classical music, its origin is from the Vedic times. When the Vedic chants were being written, they were based on the rags. And it is based more on melody, whereas every note comes one after the other. And it is a very linear kind of a formation. For example, if we can explain the difference between melody and harmony, it would be something like this. A melody. A harmony of these sounds would sound something like this. So I hope I've been able to make the difference between melody and harmony. In the Western classical music, there is not much scope of improvisation. The compositions are largely written by the composers, as we have seen Beethoven, Mozart, etc. And the players usually follow the notes to the T. There is not much scope for improvisation except in fusion music. Whereas in the Indian classical music, our rags form the basis. And the songs which are written are usually based on these rags. For example, if we take the rag Yaman, it has been used in many different songs. In fact, we sometimes won't even recognize that they are different, the same rag. For example, if we take this, Zara si aahat hoti hai, to dil sochta hai, kahin ye ho to nahi. जब दीप जले आना, जब शाम ढले आना, निगाहें मिलाने को जी चाहता है. So we see such a beautiful improvisation on Rag Yaman, which has made all these different songs sound so different, yet they are based on the same set of notes. That's the chalan of the rag. The chalan of the rag makes all the difference. Now we come to the other differences. Our Indian rags have a specific time of the day. Like there are some morning rags, there are some evening rags, which is quite missing in the Western classical music. The compositions do not have any specific time of the day. In fact, the Indian rags are very seasonal too. You'll have the Megh Malhar, which is sung in the rainy season, which is used in many Bollywood songs when they have to depict the monsoon songs. For example, Barso re megha megha, barso re megha megha, barso re megha barso. Now this is very typically the Megh Malhar rag. So here we see that Indian rags have a lot of different variety in the way they present the rags. Another difference between the Western and the Indian classical music is the rhythm. The Western classical music typically has beats like a 2-in-4 or a 3-in-4. It's like the waltz will have 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. In contrast, our Indian music, the rhythm is very cyclical. The singer will go in a circle and come back to the sum. And you'll often hear them put the beat like that with a clap. So that's the difference in the rhythm between the Indian and the Western classical music, which is very, very interesting. Another very interesting difference is the number of notes. In the Western music, you have typically 12 notes and semitones, like the A sharp, B, B, C, C sharp, D. Whereas in the Indian classical music, you have 22 notes, and or rather the shrutis are there. Now, what is a shruti? A shruti is the area, the frequency around the particular note where the vocalist can roam around and use those frequency around the note. So, for example,
anything, any note which goes beyond the Shruti will be a Besura. So when somebody says this song is Besura, or the person is singing Besura, it means that he is going beyond the Shruti or the Swarakshetra. So this is a very interesting fact. Another very interesting thing is the use of the falsetto. As Ranjini very nicely was singing, you could see that she was using the falsetto notes very interestingly. Falsetto is absolutely prohibited in Indian classical music. Normally in Indian classical, we'll use the chest voice. Whereas in the Western classical music, the throat or the head voice is often used, which is the falsetto. It can be shown like this. Supposing I sing a set of notes like, the same thing if I do in a falsetto note, it would be, so falsetto is a very airy note, high-pitched sound. And a very good example of that was like the way they put it in Bandish Bandit. The guru tells the main hero that...
May I interrupt, Anu?
Yes.
Like Kishore Kumar. You must
yes.
Ke
yes. Very
hai.
Nice.
That
yes.
is falsetto, you know?
Yeah,
you must
yeah.
Ke
absolutely.
Hai.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Yeah. So we see that there are many differences in the two types of music. However, appreciating one type of music doesn't belittle any other variety. And we are here to experience and understand all forms of music. And lastly, I will say, as William Shakespeare had said, that if music be the food of love, play on, give me more of it, more of it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anu Bhabhi. That was so beautifully explained. That was lovely in your beautiful voice. And thank you so much to all the participants. You've been so wonderful. I mean, it's been so amazing listening to you. The prep that you've done, your amazing voices. I just realized how many singers we have here. Such beautiful voices. Thank you so much. And everybody who took out the time to come and see this. We can have the house open for discussion now, please, Mohit sir, if somebody wants to say anything.
I want to know one thing. When did the script of music come into being? The orchestral music.
Neelam.
Yeah, Neelam ma'am.
She mentioned.
Oh,
you
I'm
told
sorry,
us, na? Huh, when it came in. Huh?
Could you repeat the question?
Neelam, I wanted to know, when did the script of music come into being? What's the history of that?
Notated music came into being from the very beginning, 1000. Notated music started. 1000 AD, it started.
And the script remained the same or it changed?
No, script kept on changing. The way the various symbols and all that kept on changing over the years and over centuries, that kept on changing.
Yeah, so what we progress basically gave the intervals to the music notation.
So that all these symbols that they used, they kept on changing over the years. And that's
so the modern symbols which we are using now, what is the history of these? I mean, since when do we have these?
They are like, it's an evolution basically.
Okay.
It's an ongoing process of change that is occurring. And it's not very technical as to how and when it changed. And actually, basically, when the printing press came into being, symbols started to get standardized.
Okay.
Before that, there was not so much of standardization, and composers, they made their own symbols because basically there was hardly any copying being done. It was very, very difficult to do so. So when in the Renaissance period, the printing press was introduced, it came into existence, then symbols started to get standardized. But even then, even after that, there were many changes that came into being, and actually it's a constant evolution, I would say.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, different people added up different, like even when I was doing this Do-Re-Mi, so this was when they actually started using it into teaching music, and it's still taught. In half the countries, you start with Do-Re-Mi, and the other half, somewhere you go with C minor, somewhere you go with ABC. And like the video that I put in today about the oldest hymn, how the notations were found in a clay tablet, you know, way back.
Saw that in the morning, yeah.
Yeah, how it started in Egypt and all, way, way back.
Good. That was wonderful, Swati. You did a good job.
Yeah, great, Swati.
Well done, yeah. Huh?
Congratulations.
Worth the wait.
Exactly.
Worth the wait.
And thank you for waiting, all of you. Please, thank you so much.
My script got lost 2 times. I wrote it, got lost in. So finally, we got it done. Yeah. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great job, Swati. Wonderful.
Great session, guys.
I have a question. It's about these kings used to patronize the composers. They used to fund them. So how come these Mozart, they were like, you know, they died without money. Weren't they, the kings, the nobles used to give them money for, they used to patronize them.
The nobles.
Yeah, so it was always the same story. Can I just say a little bit here? See, it was art and culture was always patronized by the royals and the nobility, be it in Europe or even in India. Still, you have so many artists, and I'm talking of the ones who paint and sculpt and sing and perform, all kinds of artists. A lot of them still died in penury, and some of them, their work was not even appreciated while they were alive, but was appreciated only when after death. So they gained recognition after death and died in penury. Those who were appreciated while they were alive still managed to live a life of, relatively.
There were many rules also imposed
upon
them, many restrictions placed upon them. They had to toe the line. They had to take permission for everything.
Yes.
And if the king did
because you kind of belonged to the whoever was your patron. Yes.
So many artists refused to do so they would die in penury. Then the lifestyle of artists was also like they spent money lavishly and they ran out of money. Then they lost the patronage. They always had pressure upon them to maintain, to be in the good books of their patrons.
And sometimes they moved away from the cover of the kings also to try out their own luck in different places. So
themselves.
Once they moved out from under their wing, then they were no longer responsible for them. So, and like that also.
And also in every era, we saw that the kings and, the entire kingdoms were failing because of, the lifestyles that they were adopting. And there were only one or two, great kings in every empire. And rest of the lineage was also, they were full of decadence and, all that. We saw all that in all the history that we saw.
Yes, there were a lot of, as always, like even today, if you see, there is a government which promotes, they want to put expenditure just on the armed forces, on the defense, or, on agriculture or whatever. Very few have any kind of funding for performing arts and literature. And that is also an equally important part of your of country as a whole, or the building of the country as a whole. So even today we don't have the kings and the nobles, but you have the governments, you have the ministers. So you still need patronage for these liberal arts and all kinds of arts and performing arts. They won't survive without
corporates. Corporates have taken over that responsibility of sponsoring the art and the culture. But
yes,
then they have the agenda and you have to toe their line also. So this is a different world today. But again,
exactly. That's the whole thing. Yeah. And the government also does it. But again, there is all that corruption.
Classical music, it gave me a lot of answers to a lot of things that, I always thought about. Like, I don't know, I'm a horror movie fan here. I don't know how many else are. But then when I saw all these Omen and Exorcist and all, I used to wonder what is this that these people actually sing, And once I read about the Gregorian chants and I actually listened, I realized that, okay, these are all Gregorian chants, just a satanic version of the Gregorian chant, like the Antichrist version of it.
It's been a great learning experience. It's been a great learning experience.
It has.
Really enjoyable. Really enjoyable.
Thank you so much.
Pooja ma'am for coordinating and Swati for doing everything here.
No, sir. You all have been
Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Thank you.
Bye bye.